into the break, you know, we were just talking about, I suppose, the escalation of property development in recent decades leading up maybe to the to 2000 and above. So talk to me about maybe some of the projects, because you have been responsible for some of the most transformative developments in Ireland and outside, but let's focus on Ireland for the moment. You know, if we talk about some of the projects, it's tempting for maybe people to think of them in terms of scale or size or value. What projects are you most proud of?
Well, I kind of will maybe start coming back from the UK in the late 80s, mm-hmm. because I spent, Brian Kelly and myself started in the 83, although I had been in the UK from about 67, going and coming. We always thought that the UK was, A, it was available, and B, it was pretty well organised. But you had to leave home, and then we didn't, Maury or I didn't want to go and live there, really. But we spent a lot of time there. So in the late 80s, came back, and John Finn and myself, we've been doing things since 1959. We tendered for a piece of land in Sandyford, 8 acres. And we joined up later with Dave Cogg and Pat Ryan and James Flynn, and we created then, probably got in touch with the first Americans arriving in town.
In terms of foreign direct investment?
Yes. And we focused on it. We got, we had Microsoft in a small way, we had Oracle, and if you, and we did the AIB headquarters and our local headquarters. We did a joint venture with Investment Bank of Ireland, it was Bank of Ireland Investment Funds. And so it was very creative and very efficient, and the land then was 200,000 an acre. And we all needed money, so we kind of cashed out. Remember at the time I got about $1 million out.
Okay, and so just describe what Sandyford would have looked like in the late 80s.
Very little had happened. It was done County Council, Dunleary County Council's land. It was virtually very little planning. And you can see it when you go up there today. Although the big development up there now called Central Park happened much later, and that's done to a higher standard. But having said that, Sandyford is coming alive. So off we went then. I joined with a chap called Jarlath Sweeney. And Jarlath and I knew one another, in particular through Lorraine. Lorraine was in working with my cousin as the director and shareholder, Paddy Campbell, in Campbell Catering. And later, of course, Beauties became a reality, which I was very involved for years. And so Tallow was driven by incentive. And I joined with, Jarlath and I joined with John Walsh, a good friend, and John McCabe. And off we went. And I remember sitting with Bill Barrett, whom we just buried a few weeks ago, a wonderful man for me. And when I think of Anglo being, you know, in any way, people being very negative and leaving aside the greatness that they brought to the market. I said, well, I remember sitting with Bill, and two of us were in our white shirts, beautiful day in the green. I said, Bill, I need $1 million to get this thing gone. He said, that's not a problem. And off we went. And created.
Was that your experience of accessing development funding at that time?
Oh, no. Everything changed when Anglo became a bank. And we had, I had very little involvement with them earlier. But they had the talent of the town, and it grew and grew, and sadly, in the end, you know, oftentimes things go too far. I mean, a crash doesn't happen at the start of a journey, it happens at the end of a journey, if you like. But that was a great experience. And then we came together, and of course, I always remember there, we housed UPS, and John Walsh was showing them out in Tallaght. This is the Tallaght kind of centre, and Phil Monaghan was building the big centre there. But John was showing these Americans around, and a couple of the young locals came around with their, you know, the horse and car.
Oh, yeah.
And he says, that's your local competition. it was so funny at the time, because John had a special talent. He chased down the tenants, and he knew he had a financial background. So Tallaght worked like a dream. And that led us on to Belfield Office Park.
Okay.
And that was one that I put a lot of effort into. Joe Linders joined us, the Flynns joined us, and we then had the biggest tenant leasehold development, or leasehold interest. It was the biggest lease at the time done with the Compaq, who were later taken over by Hewlett Packard.
Yes.
And I dealt there with a chap, an Irish chap, Irish American. And of course, the Americans are a delight to work with. They're so clear in intention. And once they decide to do it, that's it.
So would you have, when you were developing, was there an element of it being speculative, or were you always, did you always work with the tenants in advance?
Not in advance, because it was never possible. Mm. It was a possibility. We had bought the land, financed by Anglo, largely. You'd always have this 30-70, 30% equity. And then getting the planning, Tony Horn, Jerry Ryan, I dealing directly with the county manager, which was a delight, dealing directly with the IDA, dealing directly with the tenant. And of course, it was the biggest development that, up to that point, 350,000 square feet. Now, what was very interesting for me on that, Maureen and myself were, golf was starting the Paris Court. We'd been down for a game of golf, when you say a game, to try and learn together, to have it in our lives. And when we went down, there was a chap on the tee, because then he had to put his name down. And because once Maureen and I went down, Maureen's kid dad didn't want to be there, because you have to try and play with strangers.
Yeah, yeah.
So anyway, we continued. As we went around then, I found an amazing man. And of course, I'm such a believer in, is it serendipity or what? Things happen for a reason.
Oh, absolutely, yeah.
So anyhow, by about the 16th hole, we had worked out what we did. And we came in and I said, and how did you do? He built this development, or developed it, not sure which country, but it was a 500,000 square feet. And I couldn't get my mind around it. And he sketched how it was done over copy. Then he sent me on the plans. And we'd already got permission for 160,000 square feet. I remember going out to Horan Kogan and said, listen, it's all changed. We're going to drop down, create 1,000 cars underneath, and we'll do 350, which we did.
Was going down into the basement that easy of an option?
Yes, but it hadn't been done in suburbia. It had happened downtown.
But even from, costing out a project, that seems like something that would...
But you were exchanging,
increase,
you see,
the costs.
It did increase the cost, but you got the volume.
Yeah.
So you weren't buying more land. So we put 1,100 cars underneath. And of course, you needed great builders, and Crampton's were our builders. And that went like a dream. And when we had it done, we had made a lot of money. There was certainly, we doubled the value of it with the density.
And I presume you're taking that learning and multiplying that and leveraging it on other developments.
Yes, and that was the mistake, in the sense that as we travelled along, you were gearing up all the time. Mm-hmm. And so was everybody else in the market. And so, but that took us on and gave us the equity, because it certainly gave us at the time about 30 million of equity, which is a lot of money then.
It's a lot of money today, Paddy.
Yes, but if you're Telsa, or if you're...
Yeah.
Intel, not so much Intel, but if you're Apple,
yeah,
it kind of isn't. Because, so then you say, well, what did that do? Then it took us into town, like we got involved, very involved in Burlington Road, down in the docks. And I feel, even though I'm setting myself for the city, I love the city, I like living in it. I like driving into the country, but I prefer to live in the town and be in the country, but I love living in with people and in a convenient place, because I like to walk and cycle my bike.
Yeah.
And I prefer not to have a car. But
I think it's interesting when you say you like living in Dublin, but you're maybe one of the very few that can point to sectors and quarters of Dublin and say that you imagined that into life and then created and worked to develop it. So when you're looking at the city, I can only imagine that you're looking at it with a slightly different perspective than somebody else. I mean, can you reflect on places that were created that worked well from a placemaking point of view, bringing the communities together, and maybe some that you wouldn't replicate?
Well, I think when you have international reference, see, Ireland really changed around, I would say around, I think it was 1989, was when Intel came. And that was an amazing moment in time, because the IDA had travelled all over with their banks and their executives, and finally, and Ireland put the right policies in place, in particular with regard to taxation. And so they came here and they could make their money. And before that, I had a great friend in Haughey Boland, went on to be the lights called Michael Norris. And Michael said to me at the time, Paddy, you're going to have to go and export, because everything you export out of Ireland is tax-free. And not alone is it tax-free, but you can get it into your hand. It can be in the corporate, because transfers into your hand with no discount. And Maureen's father, Joe Donahue, with Novum Presumatic, at 39 years of age, he was off in Japan, finding his way.
Mm-hmm.
He was born in 19, my father was born in 1914, Joe was born in 1920. And of course, I'm very mindful at the moment of Warren Buffett placing $6 billion down there.
Mm-hmm.
And why, you know, because he is perhaps one of my biggest gurus. And you say, well, so we're all conscious of internationalism now, and we're conscious of best practice. So when you travel and see what's best, your desire is to bring it home.
And was that what you were consciously doing?
Very much so. I remember traveling earlier in Switzerland. I used to see these buildings or the different cities, and you could see where all the Irish architects had been, because they were copying.
Yeah.
They weren't so much recreating, they were adopting.
And but were they taking these ideas? Were they actually, I suppose, adapting them well into the environment? Because we can all see great architecture gets lost in translation if it's out of context.
No question. And so I remember at the time just seeing those buildings abroad that were built before they were built in Dublin. So when you're adopting things, and of course we have to adopt things, and you're doing it within your own orbit, your understanding. But I'm saying so much of what I saw abroad is what I wanted to see here. Because we had bungalow bliss here. We didn't really see urbanism as part of an expression of community, of how we relate to one another, meeting on the street, saying hi,
mm-hmm.
going to the theatre, going for a walk, understanding landscape, being integrated into the city. That's not where we were. We were a rural people coming to the city. And everywhere there were Irish engineers, the one thing they wanted was big roads. So I was one of the first, arguably, to bring that tight townhouse development. So you park the car a bit and you create the pedestrian way. And buildings get close to one another, so you create the village.